Hi there. In this tutorial, I'm going to show the basic elements of how I created this animation. So it starts off just looking at a plastered wall. Then we go on to some animated shadows. I thought that was quite an interesting way to introduce the scene. And then we finally move the camera around so that you can see what's actually causing those shadows. But we've still got an implied element off scene, which is obviously these net curtains that appear to be blowing in the wind. And then I just pan back a little bit. So I'm not going to go into a huge amount of detail about every element, because really this is about just how to create something along these lines. I'm certainly going to cover cloth simulation here and here, but we'll go pretty quickly and I'll very briefly touch on the materials. For my Patreon subscribers, I will upload this file, and apart from a few of the textures which come from CG Textures, you'll have everything in there you need. So let's begin. Start off by just adding a plane, and we'll put that somewhere useful and scale it up a little bit. I'm just going to subdivide it a little bit, and then I'm going to select these faces, press E and extrude them up. I'm in orthographic view, which is why the perspective looks a little strange. And then I'm just going to fill the top like that. I think it's possibly a little too long in the Y axis, so scale Y and we'll just shrink it down there a little bit. Back into edit mode and control R to add some loops, and we'll put a few in. I'll put 4 in, I think, for now. And then I think some more here, and I should have really brought that loop over there as well. So that was just K I did there just to cut that line across. So we'll go to face select now, and we'll cut a couple of faces out there. But before we do, I'm just going to press E, left click, and then just draw it out slightly. And then X faces. So that's just made us a basic window. One thing worth checking is that your normals are facing inward in this case, because this is obviously the inside of our room, which we will be looking at in our animation. So if we click here, we can see whether the lines are pointing inward or outward. And we can see that they're pointing inward. If it's not clear, we can increase the size of those blue lines here. Sometimes that gets to be a problem because they poke through faces, but in here we can see very clearly everywhere that we are likely to see the normals are pointing in the correct direction. If they weren't, we could obviously reverse them by either recalculating or flipping direction. So I'll turn those off. So now we'll just put some basic materials on it. Come over here and we'll just say new. We'll give this a slightly pinkish color in the viewport as well. And we'll call this one wall. And because we're not going to see the floor, I'm not going to really bother with any other materials in there. Obviously, you could select the floor and put a different material on that. In fact, I think I will do that, because obviously we'll be getting some bounce light off this, and by darkening the floor, that will be a bit more realistic. Ceilings tend to be lighter colours, floors tend to be darker colours, as a rule, at least in normal dwellings anyway. So we'll call this one floor, and we'll just make it sort of darkish brown colour. And then assign it, and I selected the floor when I did that. So we've got a darker floor there. Because we're not going to see this side, I could even make this a brighter color to ensure that more light reflects. And on the subject of light, let's add a lamp at this point, and we'll make it a sun lamp. Look from the front. Doesn't really matter where the sun lamp is, of course, in the scene, but it gives you an idea of where it's shining and so on. So I can just see my window there, so I know that the light is coming in at that angle. So I'm going to rotate it a bit more than that, and that just helps me see what angle that light's going to come in at. And then rotate on the Z-axis to make sure it's shining against the back wall. So for my preview, I'm just going to stick with 10 samples, and we'll go for 25 for an actual render. So if we have a look at that in the rendered version, we can just see that the light is just reflecting on the wall. That's not bad. Perhaps we need to rotate on the Y a bit to lift it up, and then rotate on the Z a bit just to bring it round a little further, and possibly reduce the size of the lamp a bit. If you watch how sharp this shadow is here as I make it smaller, if I set it to 0, now see we've got almost an image projected here of the window. So we'll go up a little bit on that just to make it slightly blurred, and then that gives us a slightly more realistic look. Basically, the more clouds there are in the sky, so the more diffuse the light source, the larger the size of the light source, and therefore the more blurred it is. For all intents and purposes, a sun is a point source of light, at least in Blender. One of the things is that we will get quite a bit of noise. It's not too bad actually at the moment, but then there isn't a lot in the scene. There's not even any glosses in the scene yet. So what we'll also do is we'll add a light portal. So I'm going to add a lamp, and it's going to be an area lamp. I'll just put it about there. And I'll angle it into the room like that. I'll put it about the middle. We'll scale it up. Scale on the Y. Doesn't have to be perfect, but it's good if it pretty closely matches the aperture in my wall. So that's just an area lamp at the moment. If I click here, it becomes a portal. Now let's have a look at that. So in theory, at least, that actually reduces the amount of noise. And actually it does work when you've got a lot more complexity in the scene. We're not seeing a lot of difference at the moment because this is a preview render. And of course, we haven't got a lot of bounces going on. If you wanted to make it more realistic, you could also add a blue sky to the scene, but then that will give us problems with light here. So in order to simulate there being sort of more, either more sources of light, such as other windows, or more objects strongly reflecting light, I'm going to put one, but I think I'd put at least two other light sources in the room. So here's just a point light, so that means it sends light in all directions. And if we say rendered now, and you can see there's a bright light source there. The other thing I should have done is, if I go back to my sun, I'm going to set this to a slightly yellow color, only very slightly. It just warms it up. So if I go back to my point light, and I'll do that there as well. And then perhaps turn the brightness down, try 25. And it won't actually be visible in the scene, not that the lights are visible anyway, but it just adds a little bit more light. You can see if I hide that lamp, you can see it's a little bit darker here than if I turn it back on again. So it just gives that view that there's either other light sources coming from a different direction. And you can particularly see it over in this, the darkest corner over here. When I turn it on, it just adds a bit more information into that area, so it's a bit more realistic. So that's some basic lamp setup and some basic materials for the walls and so on. I'm just going to put my 3D cursor about there and then go to a new layer. So let's make a table. So I'm going to make a circle. Go into edit mode, make sure I've got vertex options available. Press E and scale that in quite a long way. And I'm not going to bother joining it at the moment because I'm going to delete some of this table. And I'll just add a few loops into there. It doesn't need to be that many. And we'll come out to here. And we can put some more detail onto our table there like that if we want to. I think I did an even more basic table than this. So something like that. So first thing I want to do is may well have, yes, it had its normals pointing the wrong way, which is why it got slightly brighter when I said recalculate for recalculate the normals. So looking from underneath, I'm going to select approximately the middle of this quarter. That's about the middle. I'm going to subdivide that face and then I'm going to press I to inset it. So it just creates some extra vertices there and then space and type circle and just scale that in a little bit. And then just take that down. We're not going to see the bottom of the table, but we can scale it in something like that. Now I'm going to delete some of this table and the top half as well. Come over to here and apply a mirror modifier on both X and Y. So there's our full table now. Press Ctrl 2 to add a subdivision surface and say smooth shading. Let's put an edge loop on there with Ctrl R and take it up to the top. We'll expand this edge loop slightly, and perhaps these as well. And there's our table. There is a slight hole in the middle, but it doesn't really matter. Perhaps I'll expand that even more. And now it feels like the table should be slightly thicker. So I could just take those faces, pull them up a little bit. So I'm going to apply the mirror modifier, and I can now select the bottom face and fill that, select the top face and fill that. And our table's modeling is done. Now, if you wanted to, you could obviously spend a lot of time properly unwrapping this and so on. I'm not going to do that. What I will do is very quickly show you how we can unwrap it. I selected all the faces around the edge, Ctrl plus to increase, and then go to vertex select, remove that ring and that ring. So I've just got a ring at the bottom and a ring at the top. Ctrl E. And mark seam. Should have done this before I applied the mirror modifier, of course. And I'm also going to just remove the bottom vertex on each of these so they become a tube. I selected the middle area, Ctrl plus just to increase that. U cylinder projection. So let's just have a look at how it did at that. Again, doesn't matter that much for what we're doing. That's okay. Just put that there out of the way. And then I'm just going to say select inverse, say select everything else. And let's try cylinder projection for that one. That one's not so good. Just say unwrap. And because we added those seams, that's unwrapped okay. So you can see we've got the top, the bottom, and that edge. So that's a reasonable unwrap on the table. And we'll just put a brownish material on it for now. And of course, what we should do is call that table. Next, we're going to add a plane. I'm going to rotate the plane 45 degrees, just because it will make it look a little better and make it slightly larger. Go into edit mode, vertex select, and say W, subdivide. This time I'm going to turn it up to 10, and then in fact I think I'm going to go further than that. I'm going to go 25. So they're relatively small squares, and we'll say smooth shading. After we've applied the cloth simulation, you can put a subdivision surface on. I don't recommend you doing that to begin with, because the cloth simulation will then try and calculate on the subdivided surface, which will make it a lot slower. So we'll call this table cloth, give this a material, and while we're here, let's just give that a quick cloth simulation. So if you just press play right now, it will just fall through the table. So we need a collision object, which is going to be the table, obviously. So if we just press collision and press play now, it takes quite a bit longer because there's obviously a lot more calculations, and the cloth falls onto the table as you would expect. Because of the nature of this animation, I would actually want to keep that object as a cloth, but all I'm really doing here is sort of getting it to its initial position, reasonably settled and so on, and check that I'm reasonably happy with the way it's draping. And then what I'm going to do is select my cloth, come over to the modifiers, and just apply the cloth sim. So now there's no animation, it's just draped, as it were. If I were to put a subdivision surface on it, it looks a lot better. But we don't want that on there at the moment. We'll put that on there after we put the cloth sim back. So we'll put another cloth sim on when we're ready for this cloth to move in the wind. What I should have done before I animated it, but it doesn't matter too much because it's a simple object, is unwrap that. So it's just a square, so I'm just going to say you unwrap. So now we can make a vase in which to put our dried grasses and what have you. So again, simple circle, which represents the bottom of the vase. We don't need it to actually be closed, which makes things a little simpler. I generally just make a cylinder to begin with, perhaps flare it at the top, narrow the neck, and then flare it further down. And just added another edge loop there. Scaling without Z, so I did Shift Z just to narrow that a bit. And then Control 2 to add a subdivision surface and set it to smooth shading. And it looks like the normals are wrong again, so we'll just say recalculate. They seem to be okay. So I'm going to add a solidify modifier now, which will give it some thickness. And you can see that sorted out the normals anyway. If you have the solidify modifier here, if I make this thickness a lot greater, you can see we have quite a sharp edge, which may be what you want. If you put it above the subdivision surface, obviously that then gets rounded off. So I'm going to go with the rounded version, and I think that's fine. What I am going to do though is just select that rear line of vertices, so it's rear because it's away from the camera, Control E and say mark seam, then select everything, press U and say unwrap. And if we have a look at what our UV map looks like now, you can see that's pulled it out quite nicely. So we'll just create a vase material, make it a nice blue material for now, drop that there. We don't need this one to be a collision, doesn't need to be involved in the animation in any way. So I'm not going to make as many grasses and what have you as I did before, but I will make the fluffy one that I did. So we'll put these on a new layer. I'm just going to set my cursor to selected, which is basically where the vase is, and come to a new layer. It's just useful to have things on different layers sometimes to make it easier to get to them. And again, I'm going to add a circle. I start with circles quite a lot. This time I don't need 32 vertices. So I'm going to go with 12 and shrink it down quite a bit. So this is the stem that I'm making at the moment. Probably don't even need 12 really, but I'm not putting too many of these in the scene anyway. Go into edit mode, press E and extrude up. It's got to be tall enough that the stem appears pretty thin, but I can also of course scale Shift Z, and that just makes it thinner without changing the length. Back up to the top, E, and then we'll start to bring out the head of our grass. Alt M, and that will join it at the center. And they tend to be, these particular grasses, fatter at the bottom than they are at the top, I think. It's going to get a subdivision surface in a minute anyway. So it'll need another loop just here. And there's a subdivision surface. That's roughly the right sort of shape. The other thing I want to do, I've just selected a ring there, Control Plus, until we've got the whole head of the grass, the flower of it, I suppose, selected. I'm just going to make it a little wider, I think, Scale Shift Z. But with it selected, I'm going to go to data, vertex groups, add a vertex group, and assign. So just unselect and then reselect just to check that that's done, because that's where I'm going to add a simple particle system. I think that head needs to be bigger actually, because the stem should be very, very thin. I think that's possibly a bit too long now, but we can add some more edge loops into this just so that we can make it a little curved. Obviously you can use and should use photographic reference to get this exactly right. So I'm going to come over to particle systems and say new. We'll just go with 100 particles for now, and we'll change it to hair. They're a little long at the moment, so we'll go with 0.25, say advanced. We'll say use modifier stack as well. Come down to the bottom, vertex groups, and select the hair group. So the normal velocity is what will set the length of that hair at the moment. So perhaps 0.15 for the hair length. We'll go up to 500 now. And then if we come down here under children and say interpolated, we'll just go with both display and render 10. Display is what we see here. Rendered is how many it will render when we actually do a render. We'll say B-spline, adaptive render. We only need a couple of steps, maybe even one step. We say long hair, it will give us more variation. And I think we'll put some more vertices into the head of the grass. And one problem we've got is the normals. So we select everything and say recalculate. There we go. We've got our hair working normally now. It was actually pushing inwards before it was coming out. So we can shrink that back now to something like that. Go back to our materials. First of all, we'll just add basic dry grass material, and then we'll add dry grass hair material and make this a whiter material, I guess. So we come down here, we can tell it to use the hair material, perhaps a little bit shorter than that. About 0.02 seems to be about right in this case. So we can then just put very slight shifts in how straight or otherwise the grass is, just to make it a bit more realistic. We bring everything back. That's a pretty huge table, etc. at the moment. So perhaps we need to shrink all of that down a little bit and bring it slightly forward. I'm going to select my camera and just take that in somewhere like this. And we can probably go down to just 100 hairs now. So very basic materials at the moment. And I think we can see we can set our sun slightly smaller now. Maybe a little brighter, go with 3. You can see it's taking a bit longer to render now. So we need to change some of the parameters for the hair rendering. The hairs are there, but they're very, very fine at the moment. Obviously, we haven't got a decent material on them yet. If we come down to the bottom, there's cycles hair setting. Don't necessarily have to have the tip closed. That will allow it to be slightly thicker at the end. And we can change the scaling, which will make them thicker hairs. You can see they're becoming more visible now. Probably do with more of them anyway. That might be a bit too thick. So let's try 250 as the base hairs. And we can even go to 25 down here. Now you can see it's starting to really fill out. I've gone slightly shorter on the hairs as well. And perhaps go up to 500. Now you can see it's really quite thick if we back off. So let's do a few materials at this point. So we'll go for our wall. Before I do anything with it, I'm going to select the wall, press U, and just say project from view bounds. So that's just unwrapped that back wall, as that's the only wall I plan to have in the camera view. Then I'm going to add a texture, which is an image texture. And I'm going to go to my textures under architecture. I've got various textures that might be suitable for this. So let's try, I think this is the one I used, plaster colored. So I'll open that. That's quite an interesting texture. Plug that into here, into the diffuse, and just say rendered. There it is. It's a little dark, but nevertheless, it's pretty much what we want. I'm just going to remove everything from the scene other than the wall for a moment. So let's just process that a little first. So let's put a gamma node on there. I'm just reducing the gamma, which as you can see is making it less dark. It's not actually reducing the color, it's just making it more washed out. So that's okay. I'm now going to add a converter node, which is a color ramp, and just drop that in there. It's all gone black and white. Bring the two points together, the two marker points together, quite a long way, and I'm trying to just really get a lot of edges, as you can see. So I've got that now. I can probably get it more easily if I take the original input, which is obviously a darker image, so therefore the detail is elsewhere. If you find changing this to non-color data makes it better, which it may, you may want to make a duplicate of this image texture with that one set to non-color. Doesn't always make a huge difference, so I'm just going to leave that in color mode and just set this to where I want it. Really, I'm just trying to find a good amount of detail, which I think that's got. I'm going to leave my color off for a minute because because I'm going to use this color ramp for something. So now I'm going to add another shader, which is a mixed shader. Drop that there. I'm going to add a glossy shader. Set to Ashcombe and Shirley, put that in the other side. For the moment, I'm going to set this to 0.025, which is so it's mostly diffuse and a little bit of glossy. And I'll leave the glossy default of 0.2. Hasn't made a lot of difference at the moment. I'm going to add another input, which is layer weight. Drop that up there. So this is detecting the angle of light bouncing off a surface. And I'm going to use that to actually control the mix shader from the facing output. All the way to one end, you can see it becomes reflective. So that's the reflective end. I want this pretty non-reflective, so we'll have a fairly low number of 0.2. Finally, I'm going to add a vector node, which is the bump node. I'm going to take the output of my color ramp, the color output, into the height input of the bump node, and then the output of that goes to the normal. You can see it's purple and purple, these node outputs. This goes to the normal input on each of those three nodes, the layer weight, the diffuse, and the glossy. And you can see, although I haven't put the color input back in yet, we're detecting those edges. Now it's very dark because it's actually quite extreme at the moment. So we can turn the strength down, and we can also try inverting it. Sometimes it goes the wrong way and it looks a little odd. So we know the light is coming from the left. So there, I've turned it quite a long way down, and now we can see there's highlights as if there's slightly raised areas, and then that area which is raised has shadows on this side. So now if we add our color back in, in fact, before we add the color back in, let's just try adjusting. That looks quite shiny. If I adjust this layer weight slightly or make it slightly less shiny. Now I'll put the output from our color back into the diffuse. Now you can see these lighter patches of plaster are showing as raised. We could invert that, of course, or we can invert it in here and or in here. So that's quite good. It's just a subtle effect, and we can adjust the strength of that here. Adjusting distance will affect that as well. So there's our plaster wall. So let's just do something for our vase. It's going to be a clean and shiny vase. I'm not going to worry about putting dirt on it or anything like that. So let's just add another shader, which is an add shader. Drop that there. I'm making it a translucent vase. It might be very fine porcelain or possibly even a glass vase with a lot of colouring in it. I'm going to need a glossy shader, which we'll put here. A mixed shader. Put the glossy in the other side. This time I'm going to leave it fairly high and the roughness quite low. We'll go with 0.025. Maybe not quite that low. The problem with it being very low is it will show up this hole in the back here, so we need to think about that. We can turn the mix down as well though. So add input layer weight, because it still applies even to glasses. Drop that in there. It's starting to look a little better. I think we're getting an effect of our spot lamp being a little bit too close to that back wall, I think. So we'll bring that over out here a little, and we'll make the spot lamp a little bigger as well. Makes it less obvious. So I'm also going to add translucent node. For the moment we'll put the same color in it, put that the other side of the shader, and you can see suddenly the color gets a lot stronger. And if you just want a color like that, that's fine. I ended up putting something a bit more complex in there. So I'm going to add a texture, which is one of these. We'll go with, let's try a Veroni texture. We'll add color ramp. We'll have our blue color on that side and perhaps fairly strong yellow on that side. Put the Veroni into there, and the output of that is our color. And what I generally do is put a gamma node on the translucent just to effectively make it more intense if it's light that's passing through. And we can play with either, we can use intensity or cells, whatever we want to do, and change the scale of the noise here. But that's just a way to get a quick texture on our vase. So now just very quickly put some materials on our grass. So once again, very much the same process. I'm going to put an add shader on because I'm going to have it slightly translucent in places. So that means we'll need a translucent shader too on the other side of that. You see how white the top has become now because we're actually in the dry grass hair shader at the moment. So in fact, so as it's hair, what we can do, we don't want to do that, is we can just add a hair shader, connect that into the surface and see how that looks for you. We can try adding in translucent shader just to sort of brighten it up a little bit. By rights, translucent shader should always be added as an add shader, but that sometimes is a bit too much. We'll give that a go in this instance. So you can see it's very bright as an add shader. What we can do is we can darken down our translucence, which sort of takes the edge off it slightly. So there's the head of our grass. So for the stem of the grass, because we might use this for blades of grass as well, I'm going to add an add shader and then again another translucent. Nominally, I'm going to put the same color on, but darken it a little bit. And then mix shader, glossy, leave it at the default roughness for now, but set it to 0.025 just to see if that works okay. And of course, as I normally do, I'll put in a layer weight. Once you add in a layer weight, it doesn't really matter what you set the mix shader's mix level to, because the layer weight's controlling it. We'll go for 0.2 on there. Now you could put a bump in there as well, or a displacement over here, but it's so small it's not necessarily worth it. What I did do with the grass blades is I added a texture to color as well to switch between two different colors, just to give you a little bit of detail on the grass blades. So that's some basic textures done. So one thing we haven't done yet is the curtain. So somewhere over here, perhaps about there, I need some curtains. So I'm going to come over to here and I'm just going to add a plane. Rotate Y90, call our landscape up again, just scaling it on the Y, just to be larger than our window. I'm going to add a couple of edge loops here, scale on the Y to bring them close together, and then X and delete that base. So effectively I've got two planes next to each other, which is obviously my two curtains. They don't need to be a long way in front of the window, they just need to be in front of it. Before I go any further, I'm going to press U and unwrap those. If you get a non-uniform scale error up here, this is just because you haven't control A and applied rotation and scale. It doesn't really matter most times. And then unwrap and you see I've got no error now. So let's subdivide them a number of times. Perhaps more than that, we'll go with 15. Next thing I'm going to do is select every other vertex along here. And you could do that quite easily by selecting them all like that. Under here, say select and say check a deselect. Unfortunately, it only does one of the sections. Now I could just do this twice, but it's easier just to do this as I haven't got that many to do. Important thing is that the end ones, in both cases, the end of each line is selected. If it isn't, then you probably need an extra line of vertices in there. And the reason it's important will become obvious in a minute. Come over to here and say plus for vertex groups and assign. Come over to physics properties and we'll say cloth. Come out of edit mode, press play and of course they just drop. We click pinning, click here and say group. Now press play. You see something's happened, but they're not dropping, which is good. So come back to object properties here, go to edit mode. So we've still got our every other vertex selected. Come out of edit mode, under shape keys, click plus, and that will add the basis. So that's the initial shape of our curtains. Click the plus again, and then go into edit mode. You could use mirror for this, of course. So I'm now going to select this entire side, which I can do is just Control L, and hide it. I said select group here. I'm going to put my cursor here. Down here, I'm going to say 3D cursor for pivot point. And then I'm going to say scale Y. And it doesn't matter what it's doing to the shape, I'm going to scale all of these in to fairly close to that point, not completely on top of it. And what we should now be able to do is you can see it distorts that when this value goes up. So can I do the same over here? Make sure this value is at 0. Hide that side, put my cursor here. Select every other vertex, making sure you've got the end one selected. You've still got pivot against the 3D cursor, so scale on the Y. And of course you could type a number in, which you can see, I nearly pointed with my finger then, which you wouldn't have been able to see. If you look in the bottom left hand corner, you can see as I move it, the scale changing. I don't remember exactly what scale I set the other one to, it's not that important as we're not really going to see this thing. Something like that. Come out of edit mode, but I'll just unhide that. So essentially those vertices are moving when the shape key changes from 0 to 1. So at frame 0, I'm going to press I over the shape key. Then we'll give it 1 second, so we'll come up to 25, because I don't want the curtain flinging around too fast. And we'll set the shape key up to 1 and press I there. We now animate it. You can see it sort of appears to be making a couple of dresses, obviously trying to draw the curtains in. So we need to change some parameters on here now. So the first one would be, let's try silk as one of our cloth presets. It's a little better. We perhaps need to make it a little heavier, but the other thing we need to do is have the cloth colliding with itself, which means it recognizes that it's bunching up into itself. What we can also do is give it a sort of starter for 10. So I can push those vertices off to one side slightly. Now you can see it bunches much better. much more as you'd expect a curtain to. So at this point we can apply a subdivision surface. I've just put one at level 1 just to make it a little smoother, but because it's below the cloth sim doesn't have to try and calculate the extra vertices created by that subdivision surface. So that's not looking too bad, except that they're very stationary. So now we need to add into the same layer as the curtains a force field, which is a wind force field. Rotate Y 90 and we'll start playing. And at the moment it's not moving the curtains really very much at all. So we'll go to the physics properties for the force and we'll turn the strength up. And you can see that's starting to have some effect. But it's very plain, as it were. They're just sort of moving out, they're not doing a huge amount. So let's turn the noise on the wind up quite a long way, to maximum in fact. And let's turn the flow down. What we now need to do is potentially change some of the settings for the curtains. So if we turn structural down, you can see they go all over the place. So let's go down to 3. So for me, I used a mass of 0.3, so slightly heavier. I turned spring damping to 5 because I wanted the cloth to look like it's in a sort of gentle breeze rather than a tornado or something. Air I turned down to 0.5, which means it takes longer to stop moving and I want it to continue to move. Structural I had up at 15, sort of keep the curtain more open. But stiffness I took down to 0.1. And you will need to change this yourself. You need to set this to what works for the particular model that you've created and so on. My force field I had at 250. I had flow at 0.5. Now you can see we're getting a bit of movement on those curtains. So let's have a look at what sort of shadow they're casting. So we now need to reorient the sun. Pull the shadow, those curtains in a bit. But of course they're actually a little bit too far out of the way anyway. And the easiest thing to do is just to make our object here a little wider on the z-axis over that way, because we're only really interested in the curtains from the one side anyway. So there you go, you can see that our curtain is showing there. So now a material for the curtain. I wanted to have an alpha based material, so it looked sort of like a net curtain. So we'll create a new material. I'll just make sure I can see the curtains. And we'll add an image texture. And it's this one, with the flowers on it. And we'll just plug that in, and you can see there they are. But rather than using it coloured like that, the next thing I'm going to do is put that through a colour ramp. I used cardinal, which is a sort of sharper fall-off, and pulled those points in. So we've got a nice high contrast image. I'll then add a mix shader, and I'll add a translucent shader. This is breaking the rule that I talked about earlier, but I didn't want it to be a completely opaque material. Set that to about 0.175 for the mix. Set the translucent colour a slightly yellow colour, and a slightly yellow colour for the diffuse too. Make another mix shader and drop that the other side, and add transparent. Plug that into the other side, and as you're probably expecting, I took the colour output from my colour ramp to control that mix. Now you can see we've got this pattern showing through. And we can play around with this, determine how much is transparent and not. See, I've just inverted it there, so I've got more pattern there. We now have a look at what's going on over here. You can see we've got a very transparent curtain. If I switch it around the other way, perhaps not so much. What I might want to do, of course, is alter the size of my UV image. So if I bring up the fabric, you can see it's only covering that much at the moment. So if I scale on the X and then scale everything, now I'll have a finer pattern, which will give me more detail. And I just need to recalculate. And obviously the sharpness of the sun will affect how much of that pattern shows. And there we go. So there's our net curtain. So finally, how do we do the movement on our grass? Obviously I could have just animated it individually, but that would be quite tiresome. Once you've got 4 or 5 little pieces of grass to do, that's quite a few to do. So I'm going to call up the graph editor. Go to the beginning of the animation, press I, and record the rotation of my grass. You can see a couple of points have appeared here. Press N, and we get a new set of options over here, and go to modifiers. So at the moment, nothing's happening. The grass is completely stationary with the animation playing there. I'm going to add a modifier, which is going to be noise. So that's noise on the rotation, and you can see it's the X rotation. So forward and back. If I just go to the grass alone, you can see it's doing that. Much too quick at the moment, but that's also the only axis that it's doing it on. We need to slow it down, so let's try 10 for the scale. That's still too fast, so let's try 25, maybe a little bigger, let's try 40. So the speed is fine, the amplitude is still way too high, so let's just turn that down under strength. So now you can see we've just got a little bit of subtle movement. There's some bigger ones, some smaller ones, and we'll just put a random phase on it because we're going to use that noise on another axis. So I'm going to go to the Y rotation now. Again, add a modifier, which is noise. Remember, we used a scale of 40, so let's do that. So to see the Y, we'll look from the front. The scale, the strength we used on X was 0.2, so we'll start out at that size for this one. The wind is going this way rather than the other way, so in fact I'm going to go over to X and I'm going to turn the strength down to 0.1, so it's much less. But we'll stay with 0.2 in Y. Randomly move the phase to somewhere else so they're not synced up. You can just about see the X there, and you can see how the Y is following a different track. We can play with the depth to sort of give us a bit more jiggle. Don't go too high because it'll be look a little odd. Maybe even make the scale slightly bigger. Z you don't really need unless you want it twisting as well. And then you do that for each of your blades of grass or each of the flowers or whatever other objects that you want to move in the wind. And as I said, I come back to this one, this material here, which is currently not animated. Apply the cloth simulation to it again, press play. And you can see it's slowing down quite a bit because it's now doing two cloth sims. But once it's baked the first time, it doesn't have to bake again. Something we will need to do is to make sure that it's in the same layer as the force if we want the wind to affect it. So that's this top one. So this is over here at the moment. So move this over to here. And also, we can now apply a subdivision surface to make it smoother and a solidify modifier to give it a little bit of thickness, but perhaps not that much. Don't apply a solidifying modifier and then apply a cloth sim because you will have an awful lot of vertices being calculated and it will be very slow indeed. See, it bounced up a little bit. So you can see it's reacting slightly to the wind now. And again, we can play with what kind of material it is and so on. We don't necessarily want it to react too much. In terms of rendering, for this scene I found denoising worked quite well. So if we give that a render, 25 samples, straightforward render. And that's not bad, it's not too noisy. I don't have clamping on at the moment, but what I do have switched off is reflective and refractive caustics. Generally, always turn those off unless you really need them. Do turn on this little clock, otherwise your noise will look like a mesh in front of the screen. You can turn light sampling down to zero, which will make it slightly less noisy, but slightly slower. This was only 25 samples, and I think that's not bad for 25 samples. And the render time was 19 seconds, which again, is not bad. We put clamping up to 7 for direct and indirect. Take the samples up to 50. We'll come down to performance. And for my graphics card with the GPU, I know 512 is usually the quicker option. And we'll give that a render. So that took 35 seconds. Probably want to go somewhere between those two points. I did 1,000 frames in my animation. The way this works, it's fairly easy to extend that. One thing I would say with your cloth sims is by default, cloth cache will be set to 250. If you want to animate more than 250 frames, you need to increase that number. So I did 1,000, so I put that up to 1,000. And you need to do that for both cloth sims. I also animated the camera. That's pretty straightforward. Go to the beginning, put your camera wherever you want it, press I and location. I didn't rotate my camera at all. I just panned it around or dollied it around. Some while later, move it to the next place that you want it. Hi there. And by default, you'll get a smooth transition from one place to another rather than a sudden jerk. And then put it to the next place you want it to be, perhaps there, eye location that. So now when we look through the camera, you can see the camera's moving up. It's probably looking at the shadows of the still life now. Notice how we're getting some problems there. Frames per second have gone red, and that's because it's struggling to keep up. It can't maintain a preview of 25 frames a second. It's because of these cloth simulations that it's also trying to simulate. So you can help with that, but not completely fix it. Under playback, go to frame dropping. So it will actually drop frames when you're previewing to try to improve the frame rate. It will really completely be able to manage 25 frames a second, which is what I've got my animation set to. But at least it will give you a rough idea of how the animation proceeds. And once it's baked, this will run a lot better anyway. There you go. You see it's been through once already. So that gives you a better idea of how the animation is going to work. And then the final thing I did, we go back to the rendered image, still a certain amount of noise in the image. I go to slot 2 and turn on denoising, but I'm going to turn the strength down. I'm going to turn it down to 0.2 and render that. But we're going to need to render roughly the same frame, obviously. So let's try that. So that's a very subtle denoising, only 50 samples, and that looks pretty good. And it only took 49 seconds. That's still a fair while. That's getting on for 1,000 minutes to render, but that's not too bad. And leave it rendering overnight and pretty fair result. Final thing I did was a little bit of post-processing. So go to the node editor, click here and say use nodes, and you can enhance the look of a scene in various ways. So generally speaking, I will add a color balance node. These days I'm generally setting it to lift gamma gain. See, that one's going to increase the red. So I'm going to go to a contrasting color there with the blue. And then just try this one around, see what sort of gain I want on the scene. Generally not too much on this one. So I press N, I can try it without. Press M again, it comes back. So it sort of made the shadows slightly richer. And that's just really down to the look you want, unless you're trying to match it with another scene, obviously. Then I'm going to add a matte, which is an ellipse mask. Just drop it in there. I'm going to set the width to 0.9 and the height to 0.5. Leave it at add, put my node back into there. I'm going to add a blur node. Drop that there and put my ellipse mask into the image input of the blur node. Set that to fast Gaussian relative, which allows it to understand the idea of a widescreen image. I used 15% for both X and Y. Then I'm going to add a color mix node, drop that there, set this to multiply, and take the output of my blur node into the other input on that color mix node. And you can see we've now got very dark shadows here. And then just back off the mix slightly so it's not quite so extreme. And that sort of makes the image slightly richer, it really focuses your attention here, but it also adds a little bit of variation to it and makes it more interesting. So that's pretty much everything. One other little bit is just how can you duplicate your stem of dried grass or whatever, so that you can obviously have more than just one stuck in your pot. So we can obviously Shift D and just duplicate the object here, perhaps rotate it on the Z axis however we want to, and then rotate on the Y and so on. If we now press play or go back the beginning, you'll notice it's jumped back. So if I do that again, I'll just zoom in on just the blades so that it's a bit quicker. You can see they're moving together because we obviously have the same animation. Now I only recorded the rotation, which is a good thing, so I can move these blades around and there's no keyframe pushing them back to where they were. But I did record the rotation, so even if I put an extreme rotation like that on it, as soon as I press play, it's going to go back. So what we need to do is record a new rotation and perhaps change the Z scale a little bit. And I'll bring my pot back just so that we can make sure that we're still inside the pot. And then with my new blade of grass selected, I'm just going to press I and say rotation again. Now when we press play, it's still got the same modifiers on it. So they're in sync, but at least they're starting from that new rotation. If I bring up the graph editor now, with my blade of grass selected, press N to bring up the right hand side menu and go to the modifiers. If I select this blade of grass, you can see all of the settings are identical. The most important thing, because presumably they're both being affected by the same strength of breeze, is to change the phase. So in other words, where the noise is. Now I guess they'd be affected by exactly the same gusts as they're relatively close together, but not quite in sync. So we'll move that away a little bit. I've done it on the first one as it happens. So I've just altered the phase slightly, and I did that for Y. And we should do that for X as well. So you notice X is 83 for both of them. So I'm just going to shift on X for the second blade of grass. We'll go slightly the other way. So now when we press play, you can see they're related, as it were. This one sort of catches up with the other, but they're not identical. So we can change the strength slightly, 0.08 maybe, just so it's slightly less affected by the breeze. And obviously we can make more duplicates. I'll make these a little bigger, except for that one. Again, press I and select rotation for each of them, and then change the phase. I'll change the phase a bit more for these two on both X and Y. Let's move that one over there. I'm just positioning them now. I've already altered the scale and the phase for each one, so I'm just going to press I, select rotation. So if we press play now, you can see they're all jiggling around a little bit. They're not quite perfectly positioned at the moment, but of course we can reposition them without re-keyframing them, because we didn't store the position as a keyframe. There's one there, that one back there. Just needs to come forward slightly, and we've got several objects all moving around in an invisible breeze. And perhaps we'll have another set down here. And that's the basics of how I created that scene. Obviously, you can spend a bit more time creating some more grasses or dry flowers or whatever you want to do. Put some more texture than I have on that cloth on there. But that should give you the starting point for how to create your own version. So I hope you enjoyed that. If you did, let me know. And I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot. So I hope you found that interesting. If you did, let me know. If you enjoy these tutorials, don't forget to click like and subscribe. I also have a Facebook page and a Twitter account, and I now have a Patreon page as well. And I'll provide links to all of those in the description below. So I'll see you in the next tutorial. Thanks a lot.